So what are threads? To understand threads, we'll have to get a little bit into operating systems. This will be important to really understand how parallel OpenMP programs work, right? Shared memory programs work. When you run a code, there is some memory that it can access, right? What is that memory? So the memory of a program is divided into various regions. Okay, what are these regions? So one is the text region, right? This is essentially where all your code resides. After that, there's the data segment, and this essentially contains your initialized data. So what is initialized data? So this is global variables that you may have defined and you have initialized. So if you globally declare some variable int I and initialize it equal to 4, then this will actually be present in the data segment. That's where it will be kept. The point here is that the value 4 that you have specified in your code has to be stored somewhere. So it's stored in the data segment. Okay, after this you have the BSS segment. This is essentially the base storage segment, and this has your global uninitialized data. Okay, so if you have declared some variable int j and have not initialized it, so we are talking about global variables over here. So they could be file scope variables or static variables. So all of these global data are kept in the BSS, the base storage segment. Okay. And then the remaining memory is divided into two important data structures. One is the stack and the other is the heap. So let's understand heap first. Heap essentially stores all the dynamically allocated data. So whenever you use malloc or calloc, or there are a number of calls which allocate data dynamically, whenever you use any of those calls, that data essentially comes out of the heap. As you allocate more and more data, the heap keeps on growing. And then you free data, that space is returned back to the heap. So what is the stack? Let's say you have a function. You have a function main, right? And there are some instructions over here. And after that, let's say it calls a function g. And it calls it with the parameter x. X is something it has declared over here, let's say int x. And then it executes some more code. And then you have function g here, which takes a parameter int x, and there is some code sitting over here. Where is this code kept? This code is kept in the text segment. What the system does is it maintains something called a program counter. So all of this is essentially residing in the text segment, right? And it maintains a pointer to the current instruction that is being executed, right? And as it executes the instructions, it keeps on shifting this pointer. Now, what happens when it comes to the function g? It's been executing this code sequentially, and now suddenly it has to go somewhere else. It has to go to this code. These are instructions following in this main function, and then maybe is the code for function g. So it has to jump from this location to this location, right? So that is done using some branch instructions. So that causes the program counter to change and get the value which is the location where the function g starts from.
So this jumping of the program counter
costs
time?
It costs very little time. Yes, it does cost time, but very little time. Yeah, so it's a trade-off of code maintenance versus performance. Typically, you shouldn't have very large functions. They become very difficult to maintain. You should have small functions. You should just know when you need a function call, when you don't. There are things like inline functions and, you know, macros that you can define. So inline functions are basically just substituted at that place. And macros are also substituted, right? So they do not cause any branch instructions to happen. There's a trade-off between productivity and performance. Putting all your code in one function is going to be a nightmare to maintain. You're going to encounter lots of bugs.
There's a small follow-up to that. Is the trade-off so expensive that you actually care about this?
It depends how much performance you're looking for. What are you trying to code up for, right? So you remember what a matrix multiply looks like, right? So you have for I is equal to 0, I is less than n, I plus plus, right? For j equal to 0, j is less than n, j plus plus. For k equal to 0, k is less than n, k plus plus, right? I'm just assuming a simple case of n cross n times n cross n matrices multiplication, right? If I have function calls over here, right, I wouldn't care. Right? I wouldn't care trying to replace them. If I have function calls over here, I wouldn't care. If I have function calls over here, I may care a little bit, but not a whole lot. Right? What I will definitely avoid is having function calls here. This is the code that is getting executed the maximum number of times. This is the innermost loop. Right? This is executed n cubed times. This code is executed n square times. This is executed only n times. Right? So simple logic that I would try to make this code as efficient as possible and not bother too much about these. So typically what you do is you use profilers and you figure out where your bottlenecks are and you just concentrate on that piece of code, which is the most time consuming, and it's typically a small piece of code sitting inside some number of loops, okay? And you try to make that as efficient as possible and don't bother about the rest of the code. That's typically what you do, okay? All right, let's come back. So we were talking about that the main function is executing and then it encounters the function call to G. And now I have to change the value of the program counter. Program counter is a register, which basically keeps track of the current instruction being executed, right? So what do I do now? I have to change the value of program counter. I'm putting some values over here. So let's say this is location number 100 and this is location number 120. Right, so right now the program counter has location 100 and I'm just going to replace that with location 120, right? So now what happens? I execute this function G, I execute all the instructions, and once I'm done, what happens? I'm supposed to go back to 101, but I've replaced the value of the program counter, right? So I've lost that value. So what is very important is that whenever I make a function call, I store the value of the return address, right? That's typically what goes into the stack. So whenever a function call is made, right, there is a frame that is created in the stack. And what do I store in this frame? The first thing I store is the return address. In this case, I'll store the value 101 over here. Okay? And then I change the value of program counter and then I start executing instructions from there. Let's say that this function g, right, it has a variable int y. So this y needs to reside somewhere in the memory, right? And as long as I have not entered the function g, this y variable does not exist. So I don't need to have any memory location for it, right? It's only when I come into the function g that space needs to be created for this variable y. And I know that when this function is going to complete its execution, I won't need this variable anymore, right? So I'm going to throw away this variable. So since I have created this stack frame, what is the life of this frame? The life of this frame is while the function g is executing, right? Once function g is done, I don't need this return address anymore. I'm going to throw away this frame, right? So what I'm going to do is I'm also going to store local parameters onto the stack, right? So whenever I invoke a function, whatever variables are defined inside that function, all those variables go into the stack. Memory for them is allocated on the stack, in that particular stack frame, okay? Why can't I have global space allocated for them? So I could have created a space for function g, I could have created a space for function main, and I could have just stored y over here and, you know, whatever x over here and so on, right? I could have just done this. Do you see any problems with that?
try to carry load which is not needed.
Okay. I'm okay to live with that load. Any other problem?
If there are more variables than the number of registers.
So variables are not stored in the registers. Variables are stored in the memory. Space is created in the memory. Only when some computation needs to be done on them, at that time they are fetched into the registers, computation is performed, and then they are put back into the memory. Right? That's where the cache and everything comes in. Okay, but otherwise space is allocated in the memory, in the main memory, not in the registers. So I can define as many variables as I want irrespective of the number of registers I have. Yeah. Once you've compiled your program, names have no meaning. Right? It's just memory locations. Once the compiler has compiled the code and created the object code, it only keeps track of memory locations. Okay? It's going to replace this name y with 1002 wherever it occurs.
For example, recursion.
Exactly. Recursion. So in recursion, what happens? You call the same function over and over and over again. Right? Now how can you allocate one space for g? I don't know how many times g is going to get invoked recursively. Right? I just don't know. And you could write programs where the same function gets invoked 1000 times. I've written a recursive program to calculate factorial and I've called the factorial of 1000, it would get invoked 1000 times. So in this case, if we put it on the stack, every time the function g gets invoked, a new stack frame gets created. So this is for the first invocation of g1, another for the second invocation of g2, and so on. So there will be one stack frame created for every invocation of the function. And I will have a different copy of the variable. What else goes into the stack? Let me explain by an example. So let's say I have set the value of x to 3 and then I invoke g of x. And now inside the function g, what I do is I set x equal to 7. Now when I come back and I print, I'm not writing the full print command, but let's say I print x, what's going to get printed? 3 or 7? 3. What that means is that whenever a function gets invoked, a separate copy of the parameter is created. So again, where is this copy created? It's created on the stack. This shouldn't be local params, this should be local variables. Right, so what is the life of the parameters? This copy int x created over here only exists during the life of g, right? When the function g ends, we don't need this space anymore, okay? So when I'm setting the value of x equal to 7 over here, it is actually modifying the value of the location which is in the stack over here, right? Not the location wherever this was allocated. So this is pretty much what goes into the stack, right? So now if this function g again makes a call to g again, right? With let's say value 7 or something, then another stack frame of g will be created, right? And these two stack frames are completely independent of each other. Both of them are for the function g, but they are independent of each other, right? Because now what will I do if I'm again calling g over here? I will be storing the return address, which is the next instruction after this, right? Because that's where I'm supposed to return after the second invocation of g, right? And then I'll create another copy of int x and so on, and the local variables. So all of that will be done on the stack frame.